in recent, I can almost say recent decades now, I've been very active in cross-linguistic research, for one. Initially, I was focused on English-speaking children, and we really had a handle on what these children are like, even though there are some individual differences, of course. And somewhere along the line, I read something about typical language development across languages, and I noticed that they're describing these children who are acquiring other languages as being quite different from, you know, ours. So I started just wondering, what would language disorder children look like? Children who basically had the same diagnosis but who are acquiring a very different kind of language. So I started, in my case, studying and then eventually studying children in Italian who had the diagnosis of specific language impairment, only to see that their symptoms were really quite different. I mean, there are a few universals, like most of these kids were slower in acquiring words, most of these kids were slower in putting words together into two-word combinations. But beyond a few of those more or less universal characteristics, their grammatical patterns, for instance, in terms of what was especially problematic, were quite different from those in English. And that was very eye-opening to me. Things that I would have thought were, quote, abstract and therefore maybe beyond the reach of children with language impairment, especially at the preschool level, turned out to be a snap for Italian-speaking children with language impairment, because there's a lot of redundancy, transparency in the language, a very overt agreement between adjectives and nouns and subjects and verbs that we just don't have in English. And the information at the ends of words, which can be problematic for English speakers because these are consonants like T's and D's and S's and Z's, are vowels in Italian. And so what proved to be more problematic for these kids were inserting little function words but not in, producing noun or verb endings, for instance. When studying some of the other Germanic languages, after moving from Romance languages to Germanic languages, I'm realizing now that word order is problematic for children with language impairment in languages. It never occurred to us in English, because English is such a strict subject, verb, object kind of language where we don't deviate from that except for in a few specific instances. So word order is just not problematic for children in English, but it sure is for kids in other languages. So that made me have to dig further. It's not going to be something simple like grammatical agreement is difficult, or the notion of plural is difficult, or the nature or the notion of past tense is difficult. It's not at all simple. There's a heavy interaction between what's transparent in the language, what's peculiar in the language, and the particular grammatical function. So it's been pretty exciting from that standpoint. What you need to do now is try to find what could be responsible. If there, of course, we always are shooting for the single factor. It's rarely or never quite that simple. But you're hoping to find some kind of overriding factor that might account for very different symptoms as a function of the kind of language being acquired. So, just to give you an example, when I looked at all these differences, after making an observation that doesn't sound very profound at all, that is, whatever features, like I'm talking about grammatical features now, happen to be a little bit problematic for young, typically developing kids acquiring that language. So, for instance, in English, you know, in our language acquisition textbooks, we often hear about how young children are telegraphic in their speech. You know, they produce these two and three word utterances without words like the and of and is, and sometimes they leave off things like ed and s at the end. So it's very telegraphic. That metaphor works very well. We think that's the way all kids are going to be. And then we find children in some of these languages have a very rich grammar where, you know, all words have to have a grammatical ending. A kid never hears a word without a grammatical ending. And sure enough, they never leave off grammatical endings, no matter how limited they are, because they never hear one. It never occurs to them, right? So it turns out, okay, how can I account for these very different kinds of symptoms? And yet these kids do have a language problem very clearly. And so that's when we started having to think about, well, what is there about the, I'll give you an example. So, for instance, some kids will say things like him running or her running, for instance. You know, it sounds like, you know, where do they get that? You know, that's very ungrammatical. Or him play basketball, you know, what occurs, why don't they say he plays basketball, he played basketball? Where's this him and her coming from? And, well, as we started thinking about it, we realized, well, you know, in the input, kids do hear things like, I saw him play basketball yesterday, or I saw him running. And so you can actually get errors of that type, and then think, okay, well, if kids, and we do know they have a wide variety of problems, if kids are not understanding the more complex sentences, and so what they're doing is they inappropriately extract things like him play basketball when from I saw him play basketball, because they don't understand that you can only say him play basketball if you have something earlier in the sentence that allows for it. But if they don't understand that larger grammatical structure, they might inappropriately extract things. Well, what's interesting is in, let's say a language like German, for instance, you have word order errors that are very un-English-like. So for instance, a child might alternate between, I always use the example, don't know why, Christina drinks coffee, but the German equivalent. Well, they'll alternate between that correct form and an incorrect version, like Christina coffee drink, okay? Where drink will have like an infinitive ending. Well, how do you explain that, you know? Well, as a matter of fact, when you ask questions like, can Christina drink coffee, in a language like German, you would actually ask it as correctly as, can Christina coffee drink? So if kids, again, don't understand that the use of drink is in a sentence is going to depend on something earlier on, like a question like can, then they're going to inappropriately extract something like Christina coffee drink and alternate that with Christina drinks coffee, because they also hear that in simple sentences. So I guess the point is, if you make a single assumption that there are certain larger syntactic structures that these kids have a hard time deciphering, you can get a very varied range of errors that look in first glance like these are totally different things going on if a kid is in Germany as opposed to the US, or in Italy, or in Israel, or in Hong Kong, or in Hungary, or Finland, because we're studying kids in all of those countries. These are very, very different errors, but sometimes you can account for what seem to be very different errors by making the same assumption, you know. And so, but we never would have thought about that if we weren't forced into looking at very different errors according to the kind of language a kid is acquiring. We never could do that looking at English alone, or someone in a different country could never do it by looking at their language alone. That's absolutely critical. So, you know, that's one of it. But there's another benefit as well, and that is the more we understand, well, for instance, some of the collaborative work I've done with colleagues who were studying monolingual Spanish-speaking children with specific language impairment, and we would sometimes compare it with English and so on. Well, it turns out the more you know about those languages, the more you're in a position to study something that's really important in the U.S. these days, and that is bilingual children with specific language impairment. So Spanish-English bilingual children with specific language impairment are a growingly important, if there's such a word, participant population these days, because there are a lot of bilingual kids, and some of them will have language impairment just like any monolingual child. A certain number of monolingual children will have language impairment. So the cross-linguistic stuff is also important, not only for understanding the basic condition, but the more we can catalog details about different languages, the more we're in a position also to help kids who have more than one language. And how those languages might interact, because we know how each works separately, first of all. If we didn't know that, we'd be stuck with bilingual, because I think for the longest time, a lot of the work in the bilingual area was, it emphasized important things like cultural values and things of that sort. But, you know, okay, but this kid's got this problem now. What are you going to do? You can respect the child's culture, but now what are you going to do? You know, when you got this language and this language, and the child is using both of them. And so we really need a lot of those empirical facts as well. And so I think the cross-linguistic work has really helped to bring some of those facts.